I'm Romesh Senewiratne, and I'm a medical doctor, and I'm making this film to present some research that I've done with some help from other friends in Melbourne on the cause of AIDS and the history of eugenics in Australia and throughout the world, and its possible relationship with the AIDS epidemic. I presented this research in a book that I wrote back in 2001, and it explains the theory that I have been developing over the last 8 years, that the AIDS epidemic is a result of the implementation of a negative eugenics program. Now, of course, that means that it was a deliberately caused epidemic, and that somebody is responsible for a heinous genocide, and the evidence points towards the government of the United States of America and its allies. Now, I have done this research in Australia, and I am an Australian citizen, and I didn't come to this conclusion lightly, because one of these allies is in fact Australia, and I have been very actively discouraged from pursuing my research in this area, which is the area of biological warfare in Australia, and the history of the relationship between biological warfare and the medical establishment. Now, I'm a medical doctor, and I graduated at the University of Queensland back in 1983. At that time, AIDS was just, had been just described. The first cases were described in 1978 or 1979. And these were initially attributed to a homosexual disease. In fact, it was called GRID, or gay-related immune deficiency. Around the same time, or shortly afterwards, the first cases emerged in Central Africa around the Congo region, which is Zaire, and Burundi, Rwanda, and Uganda. And there were many theories presented at that time that ranged from conspiracy theories, and specifically the theory that the AIDS was being released to wipe out homosexuals and blacks. That theory was put forward in the mid-1980s, and I'll go into that in considerably more detail. The other theory is that it were that it originated from Africa, monkeys in Africa, and there was a much publicized theory that a French-Canadian airline steward, homosexual airline steward, carried the AIDS virus to America from Africa. Now, there was another theory put forward at that time, that AIDS had come to North America from Haiti, and voodoo practices were blamed for this. Another theory that was put forward was that AIDS had accidentally escaped from biological warfare laboratories, either through from America and the site that was described or blamed the most was Fort Detrick, the old American biological warfare headquarters in Bethesda, Maryland. And there were slight variations on this in that when it was publicized in Russia that it had come from Fort Detrick, there were, and this was something that was publicized by Lilly and Jacob Siegel, who were East German scientists. This is during the Cold War. So it was denounced as KGB propaganda by the American government. And subsequently, I believe that there were some defectors who claimed that in fact it was a propaganda exercise. Now, subsequently, some American doctors, notably I believe, a urologist by the name of Campbell Douglas, had initially blamed the American government for the release of AIDS. Subsequently, he said, based on some throwaway comments by a scientist by the name of Carlton Gajusek, whose work we will discuss, he then claimed that because Carlton Gajusek said that there were many Russian scientists in the NIH, in the National Cancer Institute, and the alongside where Carlton Gajusek was working, they claimed that maybe Russian scientists had been responsible for the release of the HIV virus. This seems most unlikely, given the epidemiology of the virus. Now, there have been some other scientists and doctors, notably Alan Cantwell, a dermatologist in Los Angeles, who have been maintaining since the late 1980s that AIDS was man-made and that it was created by genetic engineering and splicing of animal viruses, and that this was done sometime in the 1970s and then released through infected vaccines into first animal and monkey populations and then into human populations. And they pointed out that the targets of AIDS, notably the homosexual population in the United States and the First World, and in fact around the world, as well as dark-skinned people, African Americans and Africans, are vilified by right-wing groups in the United States, and also that they have been the previous targets of genocidal campaigns, notably the eugenics campaign of the Nazi Germans. Now, all of these areas, including eugenics, AIDS, virus hunters, and medical politics, these are collections of research data that I have been collecting with my partner Sarah over the last 8 years. Now, the official theory, which is very much accepted and promoted to the exclusion of all others, is the theory that AIDS came to the human population from Africa, where it had been latent in animal populations for maybe the last few hundreds of years, maybe even thousands of years. And it then entered the chimpanzee population. This is the current theory that is accepted by the mainstream. It entered chimpanzees, and then it entered humans through the process of butchering chimpanzees and eating their meat. Now, this is a theory that emanated from the United States of America in the 1990s, in fact, the late 1990s, and replaced immediately and with very little discussion, although a fair amount of publicity, the theory that had been maintained from the mid-1980s that AIDS entered the human population through infected green monkeys. Now, green monkeys have been, as many people pointed out at the time, experimented with or used for various biological warfare and other vaccine-related experiments. And there is, of course, a significant difference between green monkeys and chimpanzees, in that chimpanzees are not monkeys, they are apes, and of course are much more closely related to human beings. The evidence, or the most strong evidence that was presented at that time when the official theory changed to chimpanzees from green monkeys, was based on the work of a team of researchers led by Beatrice Hahn from, I believe, the University of Alabama or the University of Texas, who analyzed a liver from the Holloman Air Force Base, I believe, one of the Air Force bases, military-related, specimen of a liver and of a chimpanzee known as Marilyn. And Marilyn was a breeder, which meant that she lived to breed for the Air Force at a time that they were doing quite horrible things to chimpanzees without, and not for medical reasons necessarily, but such things as using them as test crash dummies for Air Force experiments. And at that time, Marilyn and many other chimpanzees at that time were being experimented, for example, with split brain experiments where they were cutting out parts of their brain and investigating learning, investigating vision in the brain. And they were also tested or being injected with a whole host of different animal and viruses and bacteria. Now, this is can be easily verified, and however, the role of Australian institutions in this kind of research has never been either publicized or publicly known. There has been a lot more investigation of the covert work that was done on biological warfare in the United States, perhaps because there are more investigators and certainly more independent investigators over there. However, our research suggests that in the area of immunology and virology and cancer research, in the 1950s and 1960s, Melbourne in particular was at the forefront of international research. And this work was spearheaded by Sir Frank McFarlane Burnett, who headed the Walter and Eliza Hall Institute in Melbourne. And this is associated with the Royal Melbourne Hospital and the University of Melbourne. And according to the Institute's own publicity, up to 50% of the world's publications in immunology in the 1950s and 60s came from the Walter and Eliza Hall Institute. Now, this may be an exaggeration, however, it does indicate, and certainly when one looks at the work that was done specifically on T cells and B cells, clonal antibody production, bacteriophages for biological genetic engineering, and the development of viruses and genetic engineering in its broader sense, as well as a center of concern about overpopulation, a center certain at that time of the white supremacy movement as reflected by the White Australia policy. These all, and also a nation that unreservedly, the institutions embraced the philosophies of Francis Galton, known as Eugenics. We're talking about all the Australian universities, as well as the major American universities and British universities. Now, the eugenics theory was developed by Francis Galton, who was a cousin of Charles Darwin. And Francis Galton developed Darwin's theory of selection, natural selection, or survival of the fittest. And when Galton adapted Darwin's theory, he associated the what he called civic worth as being equivalent to extremely high intelligence, which he used the term genius. In 1869, he wrote a much publicized book called Hereditary Genius, where he argued that gifted families, and I'm talking about gifted families as ascertained by Galton, tended to produce many gifted offspring. And but he associated gifted families with people who had eminent positions in society. Now, that meant military officers, priests, doctors, Cambridge, mathematicians, eminent politicians, and lawyers, and so on. Now, he created a hierarchy, or a ladder of opportunity, you might say, where he argued that the common or garden Britisher would produce only one in 400 or something along those lines, eminent people on the law of averages. He was a mathematician, sort of. He didn't quite get his mathematics degree, but he studied mathematics at Cambridge. After also studying medicine partly, and then he quit both mathematics and medicine to explore Africa. And he argued, however, that Cambridge wranglers, which is the top students in mathematics, were examples of the cream of society, and argued that with the exception of the ancient Greeks, who he believed had many geniuses compared to the law of averages, were the British and other what he called white races, which he used the term also of Caucasians. And then below that were other European races. But only marginally below. And then below that were dark skin races, specifically African Americans or Africans or blacks, as he called them, he called them blacks and Negroes, were two grades below the white races. And even though he's never been or had never been to Australia, he reckoned also that the Australian black, which is Australian Aboriginal people, were further grade below the Africans. Now, he did this by arguing that Africans very rarely produce eminent people, of course, in European textbooks. However, he argued that intelligence is distributed on a bell curve. So genius occupies the top 1% and what he called undesirables will occupy the bottom 1%. He actually extended undesirables to maybe the bottom 8 or 9%. The masses would be included within the median, and the 50% on either side of the median would be slightly above average and slightly below average. Now, he argued that in the same way that height follows such a distribution, a bell curve distribution, so does every other psychological parameter. Now, Galton, while being quite clearly very racist, had huge support for his many theories, including the fact that he developed IQ tests and intelligence tests, or intelligence quotients. And simultaneously, there were developments in terms of personality tests. And the idea of criminality as based by facial appearance. And he argued at the same time that half-breeds would have a tendency towards criminality. Now, Galton set up the first eugenics society with Leonard Darwin, or Major Leonard Darwin, who was Charles Darwin's son. And Major Leonard Darwin, together with Galton, set up the Eugenics Society with Winston Churchill as the first vice president. Churchill was then the Minister for Home Affairs, later on to become the War Minister and then the Prime Minister of England. Now, Churchill was also a very famous Freemason, and at that time, according to research that I undertook when I found out interesting coincidences relating to the Freemasons and AIDS, was that at the time the Prime Minister of Australia, Curtin, as well as Menzies in the 1950s, together with Roosevelt in America and many other American presidents, including and up to Gerald Ford, were all Masons or Freemasons. Now, given that the Freemasons were also involved in setting up the Red Cross organization and the Lions Club and many other charity organizations, and that prominent financiers, including Nathan Rothschild, who financed both the purchase of the freedom of slaves, as well as the Suez Canal, as well as Cecil Rhodes' Diamond Empire in Southern Africa. All of these pieces of information have started or continue to present an extraordinary picture of the history of Africa that ties in with the Eugenic Society and those who embraced Galton and Leonard Darwin's idea that the solution to the problem of racial, what they called miscegenation, which is basically the impurity, addition of impurities to the white racial bloodline, was segregation and sterilization and ultimately genocide of inferior races. And that meant what they labeled as black people. Looked in the context of these very carefully detailed anthropological and sociological and political ideas, it raises very, very deep concerns about the role of Australian institutions and government in the treatment of Aboriginal people during this time. And we're talking about from the 1890s through till the Second World War. And as our research indicates, right up until the present time. Now, particularly in the 1920s, eugenics was very openly promoted by American and Australian and also South African, British, Canadian and New Zealand institutions. That was until the term eugenics, which basically means the science of improving the human race through breeding or selective breeding. Eugenics came to disrepute through the practices of the Nazi Germans in the Second World War from 1938 till 1945. And Hitler, who had had the ideas of eugenics introduced to him through the universities and actually Kaiser Wilhelm, I believe, invited a man called Chamberlain from Britain, Houston Chamberlain, as I have read, to bring the and brought the ideas of eugenics to German institutions. Certainly the German institutions had embraced the ideas of selective killing, or what they called euthanasia, of mental defectives, as they call them, which included long-term inmates of asylums, as amongst the first people to be killed along with disabled children. Now, we're talking about severely disabled children, and there was a great deal of public acceptance in the United States and throughout the Western world for what the Germans were doing in terms of mercy killing. Now, in terms of ideas, however, of mental defectives and who were regarded as mental defectives, this included people with intellectual handicaps and severe intellectual handicaps, but also people who were believed to be intractably mad. And that included people who were regarded as having serious personality disorders, people having schizophrenia, and people having manic depression, now, or mania. Now, the crafting of the these terms, however, were developed very carefully, again, by scientists, particularly at the University of Heidelberg, and a man called Kurt Schneider. Now, there's some confusion about Kurt Schneider and Carl Schneider, who are said to both have worked at the University of Heidelberg, although they were apparently not related. Carl Schneider was a notorious Nazi psychiatrist who apparently committed suicide in 1945 at the end of the Second World War, or 1946. Kurt Schneider, if indeed these are two separate people, and opinion seems divided on this, Kurt Schneider, who had previously developed ideas about sociopathic personality disorders and other personality disorders in the 1920s, went on to become a celebrated classifier, redefiner of the criteria of schizophrenia throughout the Western world, and that includes Australia. And I myself, in medical school in the late 1970s and early 1980s, studied Schneider's first-ranked symptoms of schizophrenia as the what were known as pathognomonic, which means distinctive features of schizophrenia. I didn't learn anything at that time of the history of Nazism in the development of psychiatric theory. And I didn't know really anything about Kurt Schneider. However, when I went back and looked at it in more recent times, I found that Kurt Schneider developed these first rank symptoms in the 1950s, which is, of course, during the Cold War. And long after, we're talking about 1959, long after the development of television. Now, I had been under the impression that these ideas were at least, 100 years old, because in fact the term schizophrenia was developed by Eugene Lerler, a Swiss psychiatrist, in 1908, to replace the term dementia praecox, which was developed as a constellation of symptoms of young people who went mad and heard voices and hallucinated, and then ended up in dementia. And this was called dementia praecox by a German, what's known as father of psychiatry, who is Emil Kraepelin. And we're talking about 1890s now. Now, in the 1950s, Kurt Schneider renamed or reclassified schizophrenia and types of schizophrenia, including hallucinations, as had been, and particularly auditory hallucinations, as had been included in Blurler's and Kraepelin's symptomatology, or phenomenology, as they describe it and use the term in psychiatry. But also added things like thought radiation, thought broadcasting, thought insertion, and thought withdrawal. Now, he also included and broadened the idea of what is known as inappropriate affect, which was also included in the earlier Blurler's labeling. But inappropriate affect means a person who shows different emotional reactions to what might be expected. For example, someone laughing. The classical example is a person laughing upon hearing about the death of a relative. Now, of course, there can be many reasons for that, and the idea that this is caused by brain disease, let alone the idea that one is under the control of malicious agents, which would be regarded as persecutory delusions, and therefore, again, evidence of schizophrenia, or for that matter, that one is under the control of major corporations, or spied upon by the CIA, or the FBI, or Mossad, or ASIO. And these are all ideas that have come to be included in the criteria for schizophrenia and mania, including also people who believe that they know better than the state. And could advise those in authority, or could perhaps try and arrest them, these are called grandiose ideas, or belief that one could reform the United Nations is one example that's given in medical textbooks. Now, these sort of ideas are obviously to label people like that mad, people entertaining such many rather diverse ideas and experiences as mad, has the potential to be politically abused. so that people who are dissidents either to mainstream thinking or institutional thinking or governmental thinking or indeed the thinking of employers or churches or schools or universities, they can all be misused, or indeed the thinking of families. And for the purposes of social control and political control. And if one looks at the use of the term schizophrenia and mania, which are what are known as the organic psychoses, which is separate in medical and psychiatric theory from what were known as the neuroses, such as depression and anxiety, which weren't really regarded as madness as such. The people with these organic psychoses were subjected to incarceration, forced treatment, electric shocks, and psychosurgery at times, and very cruel and punitive treatments throughout the Western world, and also in the third world, as it's called. And as is commonly known now, in the communist world, which was what was classed as the Second World, and we're talking about Russia and China. Now, I'll present some of the evidence that I have after we've had a break. Hello. I'm going to continue explaining some of the work that we've been doing on AIDS and the evidence that we've collected that AIDS is the result of deliberate genetic engineering and introduction through infected vaccines and other blood products in a deliberate attempt to cull or decrease the world's population, specifically to decrease the population of the third world. Now, the division of the world and the world's population as belonging to the first, the second, and the third world was a creation of Western universities, and that includes universities in Australia and America and England and also Western Europe and Scotland, Ireland, and also in Japan. And the idea developed from the ashes of the Second World War and was adopted by the United Nations, which was created as an organization or developed as an organization from the League of Nations, which developed at the end of the First World War, as an organization to try and prevent warfare between the protagonists of the First World War, and which were, of course, all European nations. The Second World War resulted in a division of the world, of course, between the East and the West, and the Eastern Bloc and Western nations, but also along what was known as North and South. And North included, again, the Western nations, which is Europe and America, including Canada. And the South, which the line in the Americas was really probably in Mexico, and the border between America and Mexico. and all the South, and that included all of Africa, with the possible exception of white South Africa, all of Central Asia, with the exception of Israel, which was, of course, created at the end of the, after the Second World War, immediately after. And in Asia, was also regarded as third world or South, in even though it included areas of Asia that were north of the equator. And they had an exception, which was Japan, which was, of course, one of the losers of the Second World War. Now, after what then developed is, of course, the United Nations included the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the World Health Organization as arms of the United Nations, along with UNESCO and UNICEF and many other whole network of global organizations. Now, the major funding for the United Nations, of course, came and continues to come from the United States. However, the policies of the United Nations are applied all over the world under threat of withdrawal of aid. And over the last 50 years since the United Nations formed its on the charter of decolonization and independence for previously colonized states, what has happened is that the life expectancy in the poorest of these nations, and an extreme example would be Malawi, where the life expectancy is apparently around 27 years of age. It's unprecedented in human history to have a life expectancy of 27. And the reason for that is AIDS. Whereas the life expectancy in the most, the word that they use is developed countries, of course, is around 80 and continues to increase. In other words, the disparity between life expectancy from the richest and the poorest nations is continuing to widen and ever widen, and has considerably since the 1950s, both in terms of increased life expectancy in the West and decreased life expectancy in the countries that are most ravaged by infectious disease. And these are, of course, the poorest countries. Now, if you look particularly at Africa, in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, but particularly in the 1950s and 60s, there were wild doomsayers in United States as well as in Australia, who claimed that the threat to the world and to humanity of overpopulation was greater than the threat of warfare, or, and specifically they said, nuclear warfare. Now, the argument was put forward, and one of the champions of this argument was made Sir Charles Darwin, the grandson of Charles Darwin, the evolutionary biologist, who was also a eugenist. In fact, his name was Charles Galton Darwin. He put forward the idea in the 1950s that they needed a tremendous solution, even more tremendous than warfare or nuclear warfare. No, even though he was in fact a physicist and was involved in the development of nuclear weapons, but he felt that they needed a more tremendous solution than warfare to get rid of the threat of overpopulation. He foresaw in a article that or paper that he presented at Caltech, the California Institute of Technology in the United States, in 1959 or 1958, called Forecasting the Future, that in the year 2000 there would be 6 to 8 billion people on the planet, in which he was correct, and that they would be including a hungry 6 billion of have-nots and 2 billion haves. Now, I don't know exactly what the figures might be, but his argument was that this would be catastrophic because, of course, it would threaten the property and the lives of the haves. And he argued that they needed a tremendous solution and that everyone needed to put their minds to such a solution. He said that failure, birth control measures would fail, and according to the predictions of Malthus, the priest and economist of the 18th century, who argued that food production would always be outstripped by population growth. He argued this, and it was always accepted by the eugenists, and it was cited by Charles Darwin himself and also by Galton later, as an argument as to why urgent population control was necessary. And by population control, they meant numbers of people. Now, they themselves, in terms of eugenics, encouraged their own families and their friends in the hallowed institutions of Cambridge and Oxford and other institutions that were supported by this network, to have large families, because that would, of course, be improving the human gene pool. So concomitant with the genocide of blacks was what was known as positive eugenics, which was also engaged in by the Nazis, to encourage through various financial incentives and other incentives the already rich, educated people, white people especially, to have large families. However, the reality of the demographics of world population as it has turned out is that poor people tend to have large families and rich people tend to have smaller families. Now, there are many different reasons for this, but it certainly was of massive concern to social planners, and that included people in the health areas and, of course, the contraception areas and population health in the 1950s and 1960s. Now, it's certainly not inconceivable, given the fact that the Henry Kissinger, in his Memorandum 200 in the early 1970s, 1971, I think it was, in 1970, argued to the Nixon administration that it was a massive, it was a problem of national security, global overpopulation. And again, by global overpopulation, he was specifically cited, for example, the political power that Brazil would get if its population outstripped that of America or the United States, and likewise other large states in Africa, such as Nigeria. The concern was not for the lives of those people or the ability to feed themselves, but in terms of geopolitical threats arising from changes of population, whereby other some countries become more powerful by having more people. Now, there were also calls that, and a lot of parading in the media at that time of famines wherever they were occurring, especially in Africa and Bangladesh and in India, arguing that these overpopulated people in the third world or developing countries, underdeveloped countries or backward countries, were not able to take responsible decisions about the size of their families. the more enlightened of the social planners were saying, well, this is related to poverty, so you have to improve poverty. However, the calls for promotion of contraception were unanimous, and that contraception included promotion of the pill and promotion of condoms. Now, this is from the 1960s, 1970s, especially throughout the Third World, and this is before the development of AIDS, or the emergence of AIDS in the late 1970s and the epidemic in the 1980s. The calls for and provision through United Nations organizations and various charity and aid organizations, including pretty much all the international aid organizations, were involved in promotion of condoms as a central strategy for improvement of national health in the Third World by means of decreasing or controlling population growth. This task has been apparently achieved and certainly strengthened by AIDS in terms of the number of people using condoms, and also the ultimate aim, which is to decrease population. The aim that was put forward in the 1960s and 1970s was the concept of ZPG, or ZPG, which is zero population growth. Now, no country, there were a handful of countries in Europe that have zero population growth, and that is not through striving for it. It has just resulted from a change in lifestyles, perhaps decrease in fertility. However, in all the countries in the Third World, population growth has occurred, some population growth. In some, it has been very large, very significant population growth, and there can be no denying that the world has many more people in it now than it did in 1950. However, there is no doubt at all that there is no absolute shortage of food on the planet now to feed all 8 billion or even 10 billion people on the planet. There is, in fact, a surplus of food. Food is still dumped, huge amounts are wasted. And in fact, in the First World, and particularly in America, and that also includes Australia, in terms of very, very closely behind, obesity, a recent television program or a research project in America has indicated that 60% of Americans are overweight and 30% are obese. Now, even the poor people in America, and perhaps even especially the poor people in America, are also suffering from obesity in epidemic proportions, and the same is the case in Australia. Now, the reason for that is because perhaps the junk food is cheaper than expensive food because or healthy food because it's being made to be that way. Now, in the Third World, however, there are places where people are hungry and starving and dying of starvation. However, right throughout the 1970s, all of these famines have been caused ultimately by warfare. And from the 1940s onwards, the global economy and the entire economy of the post-Second World War financial system was intimately tied to the production of weapons and warfare and military infrastructure, and continued sales and expansions, both in terms of research and development and marketing of that military infrastructure. And this is a very central paradigm to bear in mind when looking for the cause of AIDS and other man-made viruses, or HIV and other man-made viruses, because the ethics of trying to save life, which most people are brought up with and assume, are not the ethics of the military machine and the people who work within that machine, who tend to see only very small parts of that machine that they're working within. For example, someone who's developing a virus may be just trying to splice a piece of one virus to another with no knowledge of what the application of that virus splicing ultimately is intended for. Now, that also includes people working in the pharmaceutical industry and chemical production, in that people who are developing think they might be developing a drug to save lives, could be developing a neurotoxin. It's the people who apply the knowledge and apply that science, and who pay the most money for that science, who ultimately decide how that science is to be applied. Now, the AIDS virus, or the AIDS epidemic, developed in the late 1970s and the early 1980s, as can be easily verified. It developed roughly simultaneously